I became a student at John Jay in 1968.
1973, graduate of John Jay.
So I came to John Jay in January of 1977.
I graduated in 1986.
I'm originally from upstate New York, so moving to New York City was probably the biggest change of my life.
And I decided to go there because I wanted to become a police officer like my mother.
So they told me about John Jay, came highly recommended as the criminal justice school.
John Jay kept coming up as the best for forensic science.
I wanted the closest school to my house, if I could have enough money to even get on the train to school.
It was a school that would take me. Thank goodness in those days it was open admission, which turned out to be awfully good for me, and I didn't realize it at the time.
When you think about John Jay being 50 years old, 50 is a young age, but it's not only its age, it was when it was born. It was born during the 60s. To come about and being born during that period of time, it produces a special child.
Law and order was the catchword of the day. It's hard to believe today we said you can't trust anybody over 30.
I mean, the very fact that the college was first called COPS, the College of Police Science, tells a lot about what the original focus was on the part of the faculty. They chose the name.
A small group of senior faculty members came up with the name John Jay because he was associated with New York. He was a governor of New York. He was involved with the Anti-Slavery Society, one of the founders of the Anti-Slavery Society, and also because he was the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
It was a very small student body, I would say, when I first started to be measured in the hundreds, because it was at the police academy. Then we were like the wandering college. We wound up wandering up to Park Avenue South, which was a bit of a debacle from an elevator usage point of view.
And then a few years later, we moved to, North Hall, which was the old I. Miller shoe factory.
It was a liberal arts institution. Its students were all in-service police officers, but the educational opportunities for those students included English and history and chemistry and social studies.
In 1970, the City University began what was called the Open Admissions Program. The student body doubled in 1970. It doubled again in 1971.
And suddenly arrives, blacks and Puerto Ricans and Irish, Italian, working class kids.
This kind of a dynamic in a democratic society is very, very good. You need people who don't agree with one another to disagree publicly and understand one another.
A decade later, the city went into fiscal freefall and lost its financial footing, and all sorts of things were back on the table in terms of whether they were affordable by the government, including public universities, including a particular John Jay.
And they wanted to cut, that is, eliminate John Jay College of Criminal Justice completely.
And demonstrations, marching in the streets with police officers.
Parading from Hell's Kitchen, the west side, over to the Upper East Side, to the CUNY offices. You had cops stopping traffic at the intersections so that the protests could pass through.
That was a tough fight. I'm proud of the people who were still here and who made that fight, and particularly Jerry Lynch. They did a great job, and they saved the college.
You know, when you think about your life back, what you've done, this is one of the best things I think I've ever done.
After the fiscal crisis, our educational offerings were constrained. They were limited by the university. And now, 10 years ago, we once again opened up majors in English and history. And now we have gender studies and philosophy and law and society.
I'm an English major
in the BAMA program in forensic psychology.
In public administration and a minor in music composition.
In criminology with a minor in psychology.
I'm studying security management.
I majored in politics, law, and economics.
Management operations and human resources.
My major is criminal justice.
Fire and emergency services with a minor in chemistry.
A master's in forensic mental health counseling.
Political science with two minors. History and English, I love those three so much.
Our history has always been about providing access and giving the best education that we can, and so justice is embedded in our history.
You know, a lot of models of many colleges and universities are in Latin.
and nobody really knows what they are, right? This motto here is in English, and it's fairly clear.
Either go to the Peace Corps or join FEMA or other government agencies.
So work with youth through music and other forms of art.
Underrepresented or marginalized groups I like to fight for.
I want to really become a principal one day, and I want to start my own school.
I want to be a social worker for immigration.
My career as a paramedic would be a stepping stone to be a medical doctor.
If you want to know one of the essential things about what the history of New York City is that we're going to be looking at, it's you.
The level of innovation for a younger school, the nature of the student body, it's got a whole different look and feel to it.
I've had students in Iraq, I've had students in Afghanistan, I've had students in South Africa, and I've had students in Dublin.
Early in my college life, I was a legal studies major. My family said I always talk too much, so I should be a lawyer. And it was the internship office where I signed up for the New York State Assembly and interned for the very guy that I eventually would replace in the assembly.
John Jay is a beautiful place, so it should have a beautiful building.
It looks like something that really honors the students that come here.
Having three floors and access to all the instrumentation, I mean, no matter, we were able to produce before, but now we can produce in, you know, five different fields.
Frankly, it's a wow kind of moment to see how it's grown. Several hundred students when I started, 15,000 students today. And I think that's what celebrations and anniversaries should be about. Celebrating achievements, certainly, but celebrating the platform it is to achieve the dreams it has for the future.
So we've built a platform, we have a new building, we have an identity, we have a mission, very clear about that, and now we're ready to jump off that platform into the next 50 years.
Happy 5-0, John Jay.
I'm looking forward to the next 50 years and encouraging the next generation of John Jay students to be successful and to do great things. And hopefully I'll go back. I want to go back and still finish my master's program at John Jay and sit in the lawn up in the new park outdoor terrace that they have there and read my book under the tree like it was supposed to be when I first got there. So I'm going to come full circle, go back to John Jay and have that experience.
Please welcome the president of the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, Jeremy Travis.
Good evening, good evening. Friends all, it's just wonderful to look out and see a packed house tonight, see all these supporters and friends of John Jay who have come together to celebrate our 50th anniversary. I want to welcome all of you on behalf of our students and our faculty, our alumni, our staff, and our board. Tonight we celebrate a milestone anniversary in the life of this relatively young institution. 50 years of excellence, 50 years of educating for justice, 50 years of working with young people who then leave here to become fierce advocates for justice, and now populate the world with close to 60,000 alumni who claim this institution as their alma mater. So tonight we honor some very special people and institutions, and you'll hear from them and you'll hear about them, but let me just say how pleased we are to be honoring tonight Mariska Hargitay. Hey, this is her fan club here, obviously. Jim McCann, where's his fan club? And our very good friends, Doug Wood and his folks from the Ford Foundation, who are over here. So we'll hear about them more, but I want to say how generous they've been to us to allow us to honor them tonight at this 50th anniversary. It means the world to us to have this opportunity to allow you to talk about the John Jay story. We also have some people who are important to the college in the room tonight, and I want to just ask them to stand. These are our trustees. I'm going to read their names, and if they could just stand and remain standing, and we'll hold the applause till the very end. There are a number of them here. We are so blessed to have this group of leaders, starting with our chair, Jules Kroll, who is here. Our Vice Chair, Arthur Morante, just stand and remain standing. Alan Abel, Paula Howell Anderson, Peter Beshar, Zachary Carter, LaBrenda Garrett Nelson, Rich Giurgenti, and of course Jim McCann, Bettina Murray, Ron Pignatello, Rosanna Rosado, Jane Rosengarten, Ann Bean Rudman, Alan Siegel, and Bill Snipes. Please just stand so we can thank all of you all at once for your leadership. There are a number of other dignitaries, and I'll always take a risk here of their people not being mentioned. You saw downstairs, I don't think he made it up here, but Eric Schneiderman, our Attorney General, came by tonight. We're delighted to have his support. He was an honoree of ours 2 years ago. We also have Malik Yoba, who from the hit show Empire, is here somewhere, I think. Leonard Tao, representing the Tao Foundation. Leonard, we're always happy to have you here, has funded the Tao Advocacy Program, the Prisoner Reentry Institute. With him is Phyllis Mailman, represents our partners at the Mailman School of Public Health. Very sad to say that they wanted to be here, but last minute couldn't. Ellie and Marion Wiesel were going to join us. Ellie received our Justice Medal maybe a year ago. Delighted to have him as part of our family. But we have another Justice Medal recipient who's here, Vivian Nixon, who is here, I think, at the Ford table. Is that right? Right, Vivian? We have two judges here, one sitting, Judge Joseph Maltese, who's on the Supreme Court in the Appellate Division, an alum and a retired judge from the Court of Appeals, Milton Mullen, former deputy mayor, is here. Still going strong. Beth Lee from the Petrie Foundation, who provides funding for our neediest students. We have so many students here who are homeless, who don't have the money to get to school, literally, to buy a subway pass, and don't have enough money to put food on the table, and the Petrie Foundation has helped create an emergency fund for them. And we have here from our CUNY Board of Trustees from the university, and I'd like to ask them to stand. These are my bosses, really. Ginger Walters from the central office, who is the HR Vice Chancellor, Trustee Hugo Morales, and Carol Robles-Roman, who's the CEO of Legal Momentum. So all of them are here. So please give everybody a round of applause for being so much a part of our lives. So we're here to start the next chapter of John Jay, and what a send-off you have given us. I do want to make the announcement that sometimes is made at the end of the evening, just to give you a sense of what a special night this is. So we literally, if you look around the room, we literally don't have any empty seats. We had to turn people away, and we have raised tonight already $700,000. So that is double our previous record. So something special is happening at John Jay, and you have all made it possible, and I want to thank you for your support. This is really, I don't know quite what we do next year. Where's Jane Rosengarten? I don't know what we do next year. But we, actually, Lynn Kroll has, and I have some very good ideas about what to do differently. So we are on a roll. We are now in a silent phase of our next campaign, so you'll be hearing from us. And this is all for the students. This is all to make that possible. So I'm going to now take leave to allow another good friend of the college to come to the microphone, to the podium. How lucky are we to have Jules Kroll as our board chair? So this man has been my friend, partner, and he and Lynn and Susan and I think we consider ourselves, we have become very close friends because we share a vision for John Jay, which is that it will be and has become the international leader, the global pace setter in educating for justice. We have some very big dreams for the next 10 to 50 years for the college. Jules, it is, who has helped me build the board that I just introduced, and he has been a counselor as well as a chair of our board. I can't imagine being here without him. And he is going to introduce our first honoree. Let's see how this is going to work. Right. So please join me in a hearty welcome to the podium of our very good friend and board chair, Jules Kroll.
Thank you, sir. Just to be clear, this is not about the money. It's about the flowers. It's about the flowers. You know, it's amazing the coincidences of life. Here we are, one of our most distinguished alumni. Jim has told me he is the most distinguished alumni. Right. And then he said, listen, I'll throw in some flowers. We'll get the crowd motivated and excited. And I said, Jim, you have no idea the allergic reactions I've had all spring, but we've overcome it. And Jim McCann, we love you. This is quite a guy. I'm not going to get into a lot of thank yous because Jeremy does the hard work of a lot of thank yous. So I want to talk about two boys from Queens. Now, show of hands, because I don't want you to exert yourself too much and have to stand. But how many people in this room are connected to Queens? You know, most people don't realize without Queens, New York City, no chance. So, most of those are Jim's family, by the way. It's kind of frightening. So we came up in different places. Now, I'm the son of a milkman. Jim is the son of a man who painted churches and gymnasiums and whatever it took to put bread on the table of his family. And I was talking to last month to former Commissioner Ray Kelly, and Ray said to me, where did you grow up? I said, I'm a Queens guy, Jamaica, St. Albans, Bayside. He said, where were you born? I said, everybody's born in Brooklyn, but where you want to live is Queens. And I said, my dad was a milkman. He had a milk truck. He took Florence Kroll, who was from South Jamaica, by the way. My mother-in-law is from South Jamaica. This goes all the way back to the 103rd Precinct. And he said to me, your father had a truck? I said, yes. He said, my father was a milkman. He had a cart. True story. So there's always somebody, you know, in a little bit different place. So Jim caused major problems in the 106th Precinct. The criminal record is now long expunged. And so before you, you have this philanthropist, this visionary, this shining man, who when you sit at a board meeting with him and somebody says something, you can hear the clicking of the brain of somebody who has the capacity to look over the next hill and imagine. You're going to see a video when he's going to talk about how this all happened. And in the video, he's going to talk about relationships because that's Jim's priority. But in connecting with John Jay, I want to talk about Jim as a man of vision. Vision in his philanthropy. Vision in bringing smiles to people along with the other members of his family. A compassionate vision, whether it's doing things for the developmentally disabled, close to the family's heart, whether it's doing things for the kids that go to John Jay, the students that go to John Jay, who have to make a choice between going to school and finding a place to live quite often. And we have hundreds of students who every day, it's a question of having a meal. And Jim led our board into a discussion about what we should do about that overnight. And he's always thinking ahead. He can't help himself. Even though he's from South Ozone Park, which is a much lesser neighborhood than South Jamaica. So I heard Jim's story. I saw the video. I'm a pretty skeptical guy. But if you can believe it, it's understated. All you have to do is sit at one meeting with him, and quite often he will not say anything at the meeting. But afterward, he said, you know, I was thinking of something. It's quite exciting because ideas are rare. And you want an environment, as he's done in his family, as he's done in his business, with his family, with his brother and the other members of the family, that enables them to see over the next hill and imagine what can be done that's better. And he has brought that to John Jay. Now, for years, I would put on my knee pads, I would go over to gym, and, you know, for a Jewish guy to do a genuflection is not so easy. Even though I was a ringer for St. Mary's Magdalene for many years, St. Paschal's of Bailon, a number of other places, any group that would let me play, I was there. So we kept saying to Jim, please come on the board. We need your vision. And he would say, well, let's stay in touch. But he'd say, what do you think about this? Now, of course, he fell under the evil influence of Blanche Cook, which you're going to hear about later, because she always told him, Jim, think outside the box. And that's something that stuck with him, which you'll hear about later. Jim has been a source of inspiration and ideas on the board and has reimagined things of how we should appear to the rest of the world. He feels that we have not told the story effectively. Now, we've come a long way since Jeremy came to the college, standing on the shoulders of Jerry Lynch and the people who were here before. But Jim has given us a vision and ideas and specifics, and people are hard at work making that happen. And that will happen. He's been particularly influential in causing Jeremy Travis, our president, and our board to think about things we hadn't thought of before because of his involvements not only in his own business, but with Willis, where he's the chairman, Willis Insurance Brokers. You'll hear from a lesser introducer later, Peter Beshar, who's at a smaller insurance broking firm named Marsh McLennan. But, you know, we like a little friction, a little competition. Next year, we're going to throw Aon in the mix. You know, it's. But I wouldn't want to compete with Jim McCann because that's really a tough act to follow. Lastly, he thinks in scale. He doesn't think small. I don't know his record of psychotherapy. I don't know how much help he's gotten along the way. I've not inquired as to whether there's any medication involved here. But Jim McCann is a dreamer, but he's not only a dreamer, he's a dreamer with a value system that permeates everything he does and everything he touches. So as I said at the beginning, Jim McCann, we love you. Now, I'm forced to bring Jeremy Travis up because now it's going to get serious. We're actually going to give Jim the award. I was going to say reward, Jim. And if we, or do we do the video first? Oh, that's why I get to do this part of things, because it's a little, you know, I defend the right side of the bell curve with Jim, and then Jeremy's on the left side of the bell curve. We have a video that describes some of the things that Jim has done. We're going to see that, and then we're going to present Jim with his award. So, thank you.
To a first date, a teenager named Jim McCann thought last minute to bring a bouquet. The girl at the door greeted him with a smile as wide as the five boroughs, and her sudden kiss so jolted him that she asked if he was okay. No, Jim said. I'm going to get more flowers. Jim and his siblings grew up hoisted on scaffolds, working for the family painting business that operated out of his grandmother's house in South Ozone Park. But his thoughts ran to other careers, possibly with the police, or in retail sales, where he worked for a year in a local clothing store. After a few false starts, he enrolled at John Jay College, majoring in psychology.
It was a school that would take me. I'd been suggested that I leave a couple of other colleges before I found my way here, some of them at Great Force, where they escorted me to the edge of the campus and say, seek your education elsewhere.
While working weekends as a bartender on the Upper East Side, in his words, an Irish-American genetic requirement, a chance conversation with a customer and friend landed him his first career, managing the St. John's Home for Boys in Far Rockaway, Queens.
And frankly, I was horrible at the work. But it was run by an order of priests and brothers
And the fellow who ran the home refused to let me quit when I went to him and told him I had to leave because I was either going to cause somebody to be hurt, get hurt myself. I was terrible at it. And he taught me about forming relationships. And at the end of the day, what I realized, in spite of the fact that these are tough guys, these are the kind of kids I don't want you to meet when you come to visit us in New York. These guys are so tough, they had hair on their teeth tough. But what I learned over the next couple of years living in that group home was that they were no different than me. I grew up very close to where some of them grew up, but it was a world apart. And the world apart part was that they wanted the same things I did. Corny as it may sound, they wanted to feel comfortable. They wanted to know what the rules were. They wanted to love, and they wanted to be loved. And that's what I wanted, and it was how you broke through all the other junk to get there that mattered.
Then, a second conversation in the bar changed Jim's life.
A customer of mine owned a flower shop across the street, told me he was going to be selling it to pursue a different career. I thought, flower shop, retail, I always worked in retail as a kid. Seems like a nice business. There was no big player in it. So I asked him if I couldn't go work there a couple of afternoons before I came to work at the bar on Saturdays. He said, why? I said, well, maybe I'm a buyer. And so I went and worked a few Saturdays there. I said, geez, I do like this. And I sold one of the houses I just bought and fixed up and was going to rent out to get the money to buy that first flower shop. So that I had my full-time job at St. John's. Every other hour of the day and night, I worked to grow my flower business by opening up a shop on average every 6 months for the next 10 years.
One day, while shaving, he heard on the radio about a business called 800 Flowers in Texas, which it turned out was in trouble. He leveraged every last dollar he had to buy the name and the company, then dig it out from under its huge debts. 1-800-Flowers revolutionized the floral industry by leveraging Watts lines to create a national brand, just as it would be among the first major companies to do business on the internet and among the first to embrace the power of mobile communication and social media today. From its start with 4 workers and a flower shop, it now employs more than 5,000 and generates more than $1 billion annually by delivering smiles for tens of millions of customers through its signature floral gifts, as well as a broad range of iconic gourmet food gift items. But even as the company has grown, Jim is ever mindful of not outgrowing the value of real human interaction. Under Jim's leadership and that of his brother Chris, 1-800-Flowers president, the company gives back to communities by battling hunger, supporting veterans and creating meaningful work for developmentally disabled adults, fostering greening initiatives, and funding education and business skills at all levels. Internally, the company thrives in the free flow of ideas to give people credit where it's due. Every new employee at 1-800-Flowers soon learns the story of Mrs. Williams Bouquet. At a nursing home, a 1-800-Florist was making his last Mother's Day delivery. Upon seeing him, a woman resident named Mrs. Williams absolutely lit up and asked if the bouquet he brought was from her children. The florist looked at the slip and told her, unfortunately, no, they were for another resident. Seeing her crestfallen, he took the last remaining bouquet from his truck, meant for his own mother that night, and brought it to her. He apologized for his mistake. These were Mrs. Williams' flowers, after all. She gave him a smile as wide as the 5 boroughs.
One more round of applause for Jim McCann. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Wonderful story. What a great story. So we're about to do this, and then...
Thank you. Thanks, Jules. Thanks, Jeremy.
It took me all day to edit that video. Thank you, Chairman Kroll. Thank you, President Travis.
Thank you, fellow board members, for being here tonight. It's a distinguished group I get to hang with. And thank you, distinguished faculty, students, friends, and especially family. It's a time of reflection to have an opportunity like this. Jules told this story about he told me he was sick of buying me dinners. I had to agree to join the board because he was all out of expense accounts because he'd sold his company. And truth be told, the only reason I agreed to join the board, not that I thought I had anything to offer here, but it was an excuse to hang around with one of my heroes and mentors in Jules Kroll, and I'm proud to say now today a friend. So thank you, Jules. Arthur Moranti arranged for us to have an off-site for the board and for the administration back during the winter. And I sat there and I listened to the provost talk about one of the main objectives that we had to achieve here at John Jay was to accelerate the graduation rate. Students were taking sometimes 6 years to graduate. And this was a major objective that we as a board and an administration had to face. And I said, excuse me, but I have to interrupt you here because I got to tell you that John Jay was 7 of the best years of my life ever. And I wish I was kidding. Now, 15 years ago, my wife Mary Lou and I, my wife of almost 42 years, so yes, a victim, so you belong at home in this crowd. It was only 40 years ago that I was hanging around a bus terminal when she came in on a bus from Pennsylvania, and I said, here's a live one, things started there, but 15 years ago, Mary Lou and I were invited on a wonderful ski trip to Aspen, Colorado. One of the investment banks we were considering working with invited us out there, and it was a wonderful time. And we wound up sitting at dinner one night at a table like this, 10 or 12 people around the table, and a lovely lady on the other side of the table began a conversation about education. She was an educator. And she was asking different questions around the table, and she said to me, did you have a particular teacher that had a big impact on your life? I said, yeah, I did. And I said, I had this teacher, I went to John Jay College, and I had this teacher, and I said, I remember it was my first class, a history class at John Jay, and I'd been at other academic institutions, which was referenced in that video, much to my delight. And here I am in my first class, and this is at the Police Academy on 20th Street. There were probably 18, 20 people in the class. There were two people in the class that were unarmed, me and my professor. Everybody else was a gunslinger. And I'm not in my seat 5, 6, 7 minutes when the conversation from the professor, who comes in wearing knee-high black boots, a miniskirt, a big old afro, big earrings, and she is in our face in seconds. She's got three guys on this side of the class yelling and screaming. A guy on this side picks up a chair. We get him to calm down a bit. And I said, I think I better buckle my seatbelt because this whole John Jay thing is going to be different than anything I've experienced. And she hears me telling the story, and she says to me, are you talking about Blanche Cook? I said, I am. She goes, well, Blanche Cook is one of my best friends. And the conversation went on, and I told her more about her, and she said, have you ever told Blanche Cook what a big influence she was in your life? And on reflection, I said, you know, I haven't. Now, I've righted that wrong in private, but I'm here tonight to right that wrong in public and tell you, Professor Blanche Cook, huge, huge influence on my life. Blanche, I want to thank you for caring, for kicking my butt. And you didn't teach me to think outside the box. You broke the box. You know, I'm probably one of the luckiest people you'll ever meet. No, I don't look like Mariska Hargitay. And I'm not smart like Doug Wood. But look at what I've got. I found a gal from Pennsylvania who didn't know any better. She and her girlfriends rented a house out in the Hamptons. She didn't know what the Hamptons was. The mistake she made is she rented next door to the Animal House, and we married soon after. I've been blessed with three terrific children, born into a family in Queens, thank you, Jules, in the nice part of Queens, South Ozone Park, where we had great entrepreneurial role models, people like John Gotti and other great entrepreneurs. But I'm the oldest of five children. I started a business, but it became a family business. When my parents were alive, they worked in the business. All of my siblings have worked in the business, all of my children, all of my nieces and nephews. How lucky am I to have a family business that we could all be involved in? Chris, my youngest brother, 10 years my junior. There were four of us, 4 and 5 years, and then the surprise 6 years later. And we get to work together as a family. Not a lot of people can say that they do that. And I get to do whatever I want to do because Chris actually does all the hard work and runs the company, which is really, really rewarding for me. And how lucky am I that not only to be born into this family, to grow up in Queens, to go to a wonderful high school in Brooklyn called Bishop Lachlan High School. That's obviously for Brooklyn because those ladies did not go to Bishop Lachlan High School. But to be born into a wonderful family with terrific parents, to find my way to John Jay by accident, what a wonderful accident it was, to accidentally become a florist, to work in a business that in a special way helps people express themselves and connect to all the important people in their lives every day. As my niece Jenner about 20 years ago said to her dad, "Boy, Dad, you get to work in a nice business. You put smiles on people's faces every day," and indeed we do. We get to do that every day. And I can't tell you today where my business life, my family life, and my social life begin and end. And I got to tell you, I'm extremely lucky that that's the case. I don't want to know. They're all entwined. I get to do the things I want to do with the people I want to do, and I get to hang around with people like Jeremy Travis and Jules Kroll, who inspire me every day to think bigger and to think better. And I have someone like Distinguished Professor Blanche Cook to remind me every day to break the box. Thank you very much.
It is my great pleasure to pay tribute to the Ford Foundation, an organization that is on the front line of social change around the world. As a fierce advocate for justice, the Ford Foundation, like John Jay, can trace its early involvement in the justice reform movement over the same 5 decades that John Jay has been in existence, which is also how long I've been in existence. Being at the forefront to change has led the Ford Foundation to support a number of John Jay's key initiatives, including the Justice Summit, which John Jay co-sponsored with Tina Brown, our Center on Media Crime and Justice, which is changing the media coverage of crime issues around the country, and for the Corridors to College Success, Prison to College Pipeline, Prison to College Pipeline Initiative. I heard a woohoo over there for that, yes. Which, along with the Pathways Project at the Vera Institute of Justice, is raising awareness of the need for college education in the era of mass incarceration. Please turn your attention now to the video screens located around the room and enjoy this video presentation and salute to the Ford Foundation.
Helping people to control the use of their own natural resources, to grapple with their vulnerability to a rapidly changing climate, to safeguard a woman's reproductive rights, the right to health, the ethical use of information in a digital world, to honor and respect people's sexuality, to give children the space and opportunity to learn, to eliminate urban blight, revitalize neighborhoods, to put affordable homes within reach, to promote true democracy inherent in the right to speak publicly about these things. Nearly 80 years ago, Henry Ford and his son Edsel devoted $25,000 to form a foundation, autonomous and apart from the Ford Motor Company, to support science, education, and charitable causes. By 1965, when John Jay College was first getting to its feet, the Ford Foundation had become the largest philanthropy in the world, with the audacious mission of tackling humankind's most pressing problems, whatever they might be. In New York City, another newborn institution, the Vera Institute of Justice, had made progress on a single chronic problem: incarcerated people unable to afford bail.
If there was a theme, it was poverty and the law. How does justice affect poor people? There was also a deep commitment to the Bill of Rights. Not every foundation had that, or has it today. We applied for a major grant. At the time, I think it was $1 million. That was large dollars then. But it's not just Ford dollars that are important. It's Ford itself and who they are and what they stand for. It's good money, as it were, and it helped give Vera needed prestige, which we didn't have at that time. I don't think it's too much to say that Vera might not be here today had Ford not been there for Vera.
That support from Ford runs right up to today with the Vera Institute's Pathways from Prison to Post-Secondary Education project to bring high-quality education and reentry support to prisoners.
We posit a number of questions at the Ford Foundation. What ifs? What if, in fact, you go beyond the bare minimum of providing people in prison with a basic education and provide them with a high-quality post-secondary education, much better than they ever had when they were kids? What if, in fact, you created innovative college programs in every single jail and every single prison all over America, so that you can, in fact, turn car thieves and robbers and drug dealers into engineers and entrepreneurs who can take their critical thinking skills to solve the most vexing problems in America, including mass incarceration and breaking the intergenerational cycle of poverty?
John Jay is the leading institution that we at the Ford Foundation and many in philanthropy and government turn to as our go-to partner to help solve America's criminal justice problems.
Ford's longtime support of John Jay programs, such as the college's Center on Media, Crime, and Justice, is making a decisive difference. Last November, Ford's help made possible John Jay's American Justice Summit, hosted by Tina Brown, that brought thought leaders from all sectors into dialogue on real solutions to problems plaguing the justice system. And the U.S. Department of Justice recently launched a national initiative for building community trust and justice to be spearheaded by John Jay.
We've seen in Baltimore and in Ferguson and on Staten Island the distrust between community residents and law enforcement. The work that John Jay is doing with the Justice Department seeks to understand and reverse this insidious trend.
Now rolling out in 6 cities across the nation, it addresses bias, procedural injustice, and the need for reconciliation between law enforcement and communities. Appropriately, its first convening was at the Ford Foundation.
We at the Ford Foundation are proud to have been on this journey with the John Jay College from the beginning. To my friend Jeremy Travis, I'm sorry I can't be with you tonight, but congratulations to John Jay College on 50 years of remarkable leadership in the field of criminal justice.
It is my pleasure to ask Ford Foundation Program Officer Douglas Wood, I think I just fell in love with him, to the podium so that we can honor him.
Hey there, Doug. Thank you. Okay, picture time for us. You're in the middle. You're the main event.
Oh, okay.
You're the main event.
Oh, sorry.
The podium is yours.
Thank you so much, Rosanna, and thank you, Jeremy, and thank all of you for your visionary leadership and for all of you for being here this evening. Wow, that was a powerful film. I can't tell you how honored I am to be here. I'm very humbled to be asked by Darren to accept the Global Leadership Award tonight on behalf of the Ford Foundation. And so on behalf of Darren Walker, our president, and the many dedicated staff, grantees, and partners of the Ford Foundation across the globe, I want to thank the John Jay College of Criminal Justice for this award. Ford is a very special place, full of very special people, and I want to recognize a few of my colleagues who are representing the foundation this evening. And I want to embarrass them a little bit by asking them to stand when I call their names. Sharon LaCruz. And I'm going to ask you to hold your applause till we're at the end, but Sharon works in our Just Films documentary unit and is partnering with me on four powerful films this year on mass incarceration. You may know of the 2015 Academy Award for Best Documentary Film, Citizen Four, which was funded by our Just Films unit, and Sharon headed up that funding. And by the way, Sharon helped me with my TED Talk, and the first time she saw a draft of it, she said, "This is really terrible." Wanda Mann, Altaf Rahmatullah, and Megan Morrison. Wanda, Altaf, and Megan have worked vigorously with me, along with nine California-based foundations, to launch this coming fall the $30 million California Pathways from Prison to Post-Secondary Education project, which is modeled after the Vera Pathways program. Incidentally, Christopher Edley Sr., the first African-American program officer at the Ford Foundation, was Herb's program officer for that very first grant, and therefore, accordingly and fittingly, Christopher Edley Jr. is the faculty advisor at the Warren Institute at Berkeley Law School, one of our partners helping to design the California Pathways project based on Vera's work. Wendy Purifoy. Wendy is a senior fellow at the Ford Foundation this year, and for the better part of 30 years has had a long association with Ford. With her gracious and illuminating smile, she once told me that justice is in the DNA of the Ford Foundation. Finally, you must forgive Vivian Nixon, as she has two roles this evening: as executive director of the marvelous College of Community Fellowship, Inc., which provides services to formerly incarcerated women to enroll and complete college. She's also here as a representative of the Ford Foundation and as a valued thought partner, colleague, mentor, and friend to all of us at Ford. So I want to thank my colleagues who are here tonight representing the foundation. I wanted to say a few more words about our marvelous president, Darren Walker. As the former vice president of the Division of Education, Creativity, and Free Expression at Ford, he hired me and really gave me carte blanche to rethink our U.S. higher education strategy when I arrived at Ford 4 years ago. After 8 months of research, including conducting some 328 interviews across the country and visiting 27 prisons, now I'm up to 59, we decided that one important strand of our work would be to fund college and prison and reentry programs for incarcerated and formerly incarcerated individuals all over the country. This was not new for Ford. The aforementioned Christopher Edley Sr. did the same thing as a program officer in 1967. So just as you are doing tonight, we at the Ford Foundation continue to build upon our legacy of social justice and equity, not only here in the United States, but all around the world, and how fitting we are celebrating 50 years of educating for justice here at John Jay. Every year at the Ford Foundation, we have a law symposium for our public interest law school program. We call this symposium Striving for Justice, the Power of Public Interest Law. And every year I quote from the same man from the same book. I'm a big fan of Bayard Rustin. In the seminal biography of his life titled Lost Prophet, The Life and Times of Bayard Rustin, The author John D'Amelio ends the book with these words. In the last years of his life, Rustin was fond of repeating a statement that he attributed to A. Philip Randolph. Quote, "The struggle must be continuous, for freedom is never a final act." Unquote. A few months before Rustin died, a young friend asked how he kept hopeful in dismally conservative times. Said Rustin, "I have learned a very significant message from the Jewish prophets. They taught that God does not require us to achieve any of the good tasks that humanity must pursue. What God requires of us is that we not stop trying." We at Ford celebrate you tonight, and as you look ahead to your next 50 years here at John Jay, always remember, never stop trying, never stop striving, because freedom and justice is never a final act. Thank you very much.
Please welcome the Executive Vice President and General Counsel of Marsh & McLennan Companies, a trustee of the John Jay College Foundation, and one of tonight's gala co-chairs, Peter Beshar.
All right, good evening. Oh, let's try that again. Good evening. All right, now we're getting somewhere. Would everybody please give it up for Jim McCann and Doug Wood for their beautiful... I thought it was really important to recognize them for how well they have played their role in this evening's festivities as the warm-up act for Mariska Hargitay. Thank you. They're laughing down here. Well done. So, Jim, I know the flowers are beautiful, and you're a successful businessman, chairman of the number three insurance broker in the world. That's all fine, but did hundreds of students line up to have their photo taken with you during the reception? I think not, Jim. So for the past 16 years, Mariska Hargitay has starred as Detective Olivia Benson on Law & Order Special Victims Unit. Indeed! A show that has spurred so many students to come to this institution and to pursue careers in criminal justice. For her mesmerizing performances, Mariska has won Emmys and Golden Globe Awards. And she's even fluent in multiple languages, which she's put to great effect on the show by interrogating unwitting witnesses and suspects in Hungarian. So Mariska, Oscar Wilde famously said that life imitates art more than the opposite. And through your role on Law & Order and the extraordinary reaction that you've received from thousands of victims of assault that have sensitized you to this epidemic, you've decided to do something about it and to take action. And in 2004, Mariska established the Joyful Heart Foundation that provides support to victims of sexual assault, domestic abuse, and child abuse. Indeed. And she's raised in the process more than tens of millions of dollars for the organization. That's pretty extraordinary. So that sounds like it's enough, right? Pretty incredible. But it turns out that just on Sunday night, she starred in Taylor Swift's latest music video. I see some nodding heads in somewhere around the room. We'll explain this to you, the older folks in the room. In the music video Bad Blood, starring as the character? Justice, thank you very much. You can't make this up. It is incredible. So could there possibly be a more deserving recipient of the John Jay Civic Leadership Award? So as Warner Wolf used to say, let's go to the videotape.
Cut.
No.
Cut.
Say it. Who knows when you want to say it.
Okay, great.
Okay, great.
You okay on this mic?
You can do a selfie.
With no more, we are going to set these issues on fire.
Mariska Hargitay has received 8 Emmy nominations and won the Outstanding Lead Actress Emmy for her portrayal of Detective Olivia Benson in Law & Order Special Victims Unit, which has also earned her 2 Golden Globe nominations and a Golden Globe Award.
I went on ride-alongs, and I spent time with cops, and one in particular named Detective Tanya Cawley, who I was blown away by. This woman, she was so strong, and if you've met her, she's like a badass. And so you're sort of intimidated by her because she does not play. And she has this face. But the other side of her was so compassionate and not cut off and open. And I admired that so much.
You think that you've put people through hell? It will rain back down on you.
One of the things that I heard in the letters that I was receiving, women disclosing to me, an actor on television, their stories of abuse.
Every 2 minutes in the United States, somebody is sexually assaulted. Every 9 seconds, a woman is beaten. Every day, more than 3 women are killed by an intimate partner, and every day, 5 children die.
I'm very proud to say our mission is to heal and educate and empower survivors of sexual assault, domestic violence, and child abuse. No more shame, no more stigma.
Since the beginning of Joyful Heart, there have been these signposts that have told us that we are indeed on the right road.
Today, an NBC star was here in Detroit pushing for rape kit reform.
Hundreds of thousands of rape kits sit untested in police and crime lab storage facilities.
We are consciously letting criminals walk again.
We have an opportunity to prevent crime.
What if we could create a community where survivors could come forward and tell their stories, where perpetrators were held accountable?
Survivors deserve to experience justice. They deserve everything that we can give them to heal.
I just want to say that when I started out on this journey, I was an actress and very happy that I just landed a gig on a TV show. And I didn't know that I would start a foundation. I didn't know that Joyful Heart would have a place in the first ever White House roundtable on sexual violence. I did not know that I would ever get to meet the president and stand with Joe Biden, my hero, who wrote the original VAWA legislation. I did not know that I would have the privilege of seeing survivors take the courageous steps toward healing and reclaiming their lives.
No more. She's too smart to let that happen.
No more. He didn't mean it.
No more. She was asking for it.
No more. Boys will be boys.
No more. I'll say something next time.
No more. We don't talk about that.
No more bystanding.
No more ignorance.
No more excuses.
No more.
Pictures first.
Pictures
okay.
First. Here, we'll get this done.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm very moved right now. And I have my little speech here, but I do want to say something. No truer line was said in that video, that when I started out, I was just an actor who was happy to land a gig on a TV show. And this is a marker tonight, I believe you said, Jim, that when life intersects your career, and I'm so moved to be here. I really am, and it's such a I'm sitting here going, "Why? You know, how did this happen? I used to be on like Falcon Crest." And I'm sitting here with all of you, real life heroes, real life people that are making a difference, and I'm so deeply honored, truly, to be standing among you. So I've tried in my life to follow the signposts, and the signposts led me here tonight. I believe it was a year ago that this awesome institution contacted me and asked me if I would come and speak tonight. And I tell you, I my schedule's a little nuts because we shoot long hours and many months, and it's kind of nuts because I've been on the show since I was four. But I said yes to this. I said yes, and I said yes from here. So that's my little preamble. Thank you. So this is a great honor for me, needless to say. So I thank you, and I want to thank you, deep thanks to President Travis, who is my friend. I say that because he let me shoot in his office on the sixth floor. So I felt like, excuse me, this is my scene. Step aside. And also to the chairman, Jules Kroll. I think I have a crush on you. Yeah, I said it. Peter's here. It's all good. But you are... speak from the heart, and I can see clearly what drives you. And to my fellow recipients, I'm honored to stand with you. Flower Man. Doug. So, and also to all the gala chairs who made this evening possible. Joyful Heart just had our gala, so gala chairs are very near and dear to my heart, and I understand that they make this evening possible, so thank you for that. And thank you to, obviously, everybody, the John Jay College Foundation trustees for having me. And thank you to Peter. What a lovely, amazing introduction. Do you travel? I think I only want to be introduced by you, and I do speak 15 languages. So, I am honored to take this opportunity to speak with you all tonight. The first thing that I want to do, that I have to do, actually, is to, I'm going to call you out. I'm going to call you out on your 50th anniversary. Just so you know, guys, 2014 was the 50th anniversary since John Jay was founded in 1964. Now, they started admitting students in 1965, but still it was founded in 1964. Awkward. But you know what? I firmly believe in a year-long birthday celebration. And I mean, especially for your 50th. And, you know, I just always wonder what that's going to be like, you know, when I get there. Because I also was born in 64, but I'm only 32. I know it's weird. I don't understand. So, I don't know, we'll figure that out later. I'm sure somebody's better good with the calculator. And I also have to say that I shoot here so often that I feel like I'm enrolled here by association. You know, if students come up to me and they're like, "Oh, I go to John Jay." I'm like, "Oh, me too." And, you know, I probably spent more time here than in my actual college. Yeah, that's a joke. No, I was a good student, I swear. So... let's get serious. 50 years of educating fierce advocates for justice. I want to say simply that I am so grateful for the young people that John Jay has sent and is still sending into this world. God knows we need them. And I also want to say this. The world also needs all of you. All of you. The word advocate, as many of you know, comes from the Latin advocare, to cry out, to call out. And it would be uncharacteristic of me, almost irresponsible, to have this opportunity to speak in a room like this with all of you and not advocate. What am I calling out to all of you for? Simply this: advocacy. So I imagine that you know that the word has come not only to mean calling out or crying out, but calling out on behalf of another,
calling out on behalf of someone else. This room is filled with people, me included, who have a voice in society, who have a voice in this world. And I know I often forget how fortunate I am to have that voice. And you don't need me to tell you that that is not the case for everyone. Race, gender, social class, sexual orientation, all of these factors, along with many others, can contribute to delegitimizing, undermining, or outright silencing a voice in society. In my case, I've had the privilege, along with everybody at Joyful Heart, of advocating for survivors of sexual assault, domestic violence, and child abuse. The reason for their silence, why they don't come forward to talk about what happened to them, are multifaceted and often unique to each individual survivor and their story. But one significant and often dismaying reason for their silence is the victim-blaming attitudes that pervade our society. And let me tell you that when a survivor is brave enough to open that door into her experience, a question, or even an attitude that suggests a question, like, why were you out so late? Why were you dancing like that? Why didn't you just leave? What were you wearing? Can not only slam the door that is open shut, but leave an even more deeply wounded person on the other side of it, sliding the door closed, and often permanently. That is my advocacy. What is yours? For whom do you use your voice? On whose behalf will you make noise in this world? I know that there are many, many, many people in this room who have robust and very inspiring answers to that question, but I want all of you, all of us, to embrace this beautiful adjective that John Jay uses. The institution's aim is for a fierce advocate. Fierce advocates out into this world. I urge you to be fierce, no less fierce. And does that mean that you have to start a foundation? Does that mean that everybody needs to quit their job and go into full advocacy? Absolutely not. Your advocacy can happen in your boardroom, in your hiring, in the way that you run your companies. It can happen at a dinner table, the way you speak to people with whom you have contact every single day, the conversations that you're willing to have at a dinner party. I'm asking you to be bold, to dig deep into hard topics. I'm asking you, all of us, me included, to be the brave ones, to be the brave ones. To be the brave ones to represent the people that don't have voices for whatever reason. So I'm asking you to initiate, to foster, to lead conversations, not only as a way of searching for answers, not only as a way to raise awareness, but also as a way of letting those know whom you're advocating for hear your concern, hear your compassion, and your commitment to change. Why? Because we love justice. That's why you're here, right? Supporting an institution that is so deeply dedicated to it. An institution named after John Jay, and I know a lot of this was covered in that initial video, but you guys were talking, so I'm gonna say it again. The first Chief Justice of the United States, who led efforts to abolish slavery in New York State, first in 1777, and again in 1785, and then finally, successfully, as governor of New York in 1799. That's fierce advocacy. Well over 100 years ago, as you know, when it comes to the first pursuit of justice, There is much, much, much work to be done. I look forward to advocating with all of you. Thank you for having me. This is a great honor. Thank you.
Please stand. Mariska Hargitay. Mariska, that was so deep and moving and challenging and appropriate for this occasion. We're very, very grateful. And you're welcome to come back to my office anytime. So we've come to the almost end of a remarkable evening together. I want to ask you first to join me in thanking the staff who made this possible, starting with Jane Rosengarten and her remarkable team. If you just stand wherever you are, just this happens not by magic, but by a lot of hard work. One more round of applause for our honorees, Jim McCann, Doug Wood, representing the Ford Foundation, and Mariska Hargitay. And if the spirit moves you after the evening, I want to invite you out to the Jaywalk, see those open doors out there, for dessert and coffee. So here's a little story about the Jaywalk. When Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill designed this wonderful building, they created a commons. And it was called that on the architectural plan, the commons. And another architectural plan said that maybe this was the plaza. Somebody else on my staff said, well, we should have a quad, like, you know, Yale has a quad. And so we decided the way to resolve this naming question was to ask the students, what should they call it? Vote among those three options or give me another better choice. And one of our students on the first day of this three-day election said, it is the Jaywalk. So that's the Jaywalk. No one else has a Jaywalk. We have a Jaywalk. So please enjoy the Jaywalk. But I just want to share some thoughts. I mean, this is a remarkable moment in the life of this college. It's 50 years. We were founded at a time of profound national turmoil in 1964. We actually had that debate. So there were presidential commissions talking about the urban unrest, about the racial divide, about tension between police and communities of color. Does any of that sound familiar? About the need to improve our response to crime, to do something for the men and women who are called to service to be law enforcement officers, to do something about prisons and the role of the criminal justice system. All of that was a new discussion in the mid-1960s. And as part of that discussion, this city, our university, decided to heed the call of those presidential commissions and to create a college. Not a department, not part of sociology, not part of some other discipline, but an entire liberal arts college devoted to the study of justice. That's what happened during a time of national turmoil. Now, 50 years later, we look back and we realize that those were very prescient decisions. I honor the people. We all should honor the people who sat in those rooms in the police department and the City University of New York and said, let's create a college. Originally called the College of Police Science, now called John Jay, but let's create a liberal arts institution. Because what we know is the people who do this hard work on behalf of our country, what they need is a good education. That decision, almost upended by the fiscal crisis when this college almost went under. That decision resonates today. 55,000 alumni in this room, Commissioner Bratton and I welcomed the people who now work at the police department or alumni of John Jay who have worked at the police department. 5,000 John Jay alumni have gone to work in our police department. And we have people spread around the world. We have judges, we have lawyers, we have forensic scientists, we have doctors. They came here because they were highly motivated. to get an education. They came here, working class students, immigrant students. Today our students are three-quarters students of color, 40% of them born in another country, a third of them speaking a language other than English at home, almost 50% of them the first in their family to go to college. This is the dream of the City University of New York. This is our dream. So my thought, and I want to share it with you, sitting here tonight, is that 50 years later, now more than ever is our time. Look at what's happening around our country. There is this, in the middle of all of this turmoil about policing and awful situations of men being killed by police officers, in the middle of that turmoil, in the middle of the very depressing realities of mass incarceration, there is this optimism that we can do things better. Not just a little better, but a lot better. And that's what keeps so many of us going every day. So as you think about finishing your conversations and moving on to the jaywalk, here's the thought I want you to keep in mind. Now is our time. Now is the time for this institution to do things for the country that we were formed to do. Now is the time for those 15,000 students who come here to study, many of them poor, many of them struggling, many of them trying to figure it out, young people who don't know what college means because no one in their family went to college before them. Now is our time to help them figure out their life path, to help them get a good education provided by our first-rate faculty, to provide them the financial support they need, to provide them the career opportunities they need, to help them think about law school, PhD programs, medical school, or to become, like our president, a community organizer. Who knows? Now is our time to help them. Now is our time to help the cities that are struggling with still way too much violence, deeply embedded violence. We have people here, we have professors here who are working on this around the country. They need support, but now is our time to help make that a reality, that levels of violence can be reduced and we can live in safety. Now is our time to think about those police officers who respond selflessly, bravely, taking their lives in their hands as they do the hard work of law enforcement. We need to help them be ready to answer that call and those calls every day. Now is the time for us to think, as Mariska has challenged us to do, about those victims and survivors who are struggling to find their way back to a life that they were intended to have that has been disrupted, sometimes brutally, by the crime that they suffered. They're struggling to recover. They're hungry for some version of justice that we don't give them. Now is the time for us to think about those prisoners who, as we stand here, are sitting in cells far away, wondering, where's justice for me? How do I think about the life that, since most of them return home, the life that awaits me when I return home to family and community? How do we help prepare them for that inevitable return home? Now is the time to think about them as well. Now is the time for us to think about countries far away. We have worked all over the globe now by the global John Jay that we don't talk about much, but I'm going to China for 10 days to talk to our university partners in Beijing and Taiwan who are interested in learning from us about how to develop democratic policing styles and how to work on to avoid false confessions. I participated in this conference on the death penalty in Beijing. It was remarkable. They wanted to talk to us. So now is the time to think about them and to think about what we can learn from them as well. It's not only a one-way street, it's a two-way street. And now, in particular, I think it's the time for us to recognize that the work on racial justice is far from over, and that this college, you heard about the initiative that we are sponsoring here with the help of the Justice Department. You heard about work we're doing in many of our research centers. We're everywhere on the issue of race and justice and policing and violence. And now is the time for us really to think deeply about the legacy of the African people in this country, those who trace their lineage not to the immigrant story but to the slavery story, who are still trying to figure out what citizenship means in this country, and how does the era of mass incarceration impact the lifetime of a young black man who has a 1 in 3 chance of spending a year in prison in his life? How does the interaction day to day with police that's so heightened in too many cities around the country affect the relationship between those young individuals and the police? And how do we start to think about a process of making things right, of recognizing harms done over the years, and to think about a process of racial reconciliation that will, for once and ever, bring us to a point where we really have some justice, in addition to the criminal justice, we have some justice that addresses that legacy. So as I stand here tonight, and thank you all for coming, and really inspired by Mariska to go deeper than the traditional closing of a gala, I really think that now is the time for us to do the work that you asked us to do, to find in whatever pocket of our soul is the place where we have that thing called justice, to find out what we're going to do after tonight. We are so grateful to all of you for coming, for being part of this grand experiment called John Jay, for believing in us, for believing in our students, for believing in the way that we have defined justice, which is as big as it can be, and for believing in the promise of this unique public institution to do public good. Enjoy the Jaywalk. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to our honorees.